It's good to see you this morning. We've got a nice, cool, crisp, frosty morning out there this morning. Hope everybody got their delicate plants put up. I know Daryl said he might have missed one this morning that he didn't get put up. But, yeah, old man winter's going to get closer here the next few weeks. But we better enjoy these nice, beautiful days that the Lord has given us. If we have any visitors here with us this morning, there should be little yellow cards that's in each corner of the pews. And if you'd like to fill one of those out and drop it in the plates, offering plates that are in the front and in the back, just to give us, if you have any questions or any concerns that you'd like to talk to somebody in the church, the pastor, or just to have a little more information about ourselves here at Bethel, just drop that in and we'll be glad to get back in touch with you and just to welcome you this morning and being here with us. Do we have anything from the congregation this morning, any messages or thing that we need to... We will have the pantry again here. It'll be a week from Tuesday, back out in the shelter house like we done last month, looking for people to help with that. And I think this time we'd like to have some people come in to Love Chapel to help package those things this time. Last time they had some extra volunteers there, and they kind of done that for us. But we would like to do that and then bring it out here for that Tuesday's delivery. Yes. Oh, they do? Okay. I know we kind of talked that it was kind of iffy or what we might be doing. So we kind of get a break this time too, but I'm sure in the future we will have to do some of our own packing on that. So just kind of keep that in mind. Also, we were going to have the council meeting. It was for this Tuesday. But that has been canceled because of so many people traveling and going to be gone. Have we got a date that we're actually going to do that yet? We talked about the next Monday or Thursday possibly. So we'll let you know when that is actually going to occur because we do have to get together for some items before the end of the month. So is there anything else this morning? If not, I'd like to do a reading out of the book of Psalms, Psalm 95. And it says, "Come, let us shout joyfully to the Lord. Shout triumphantly to the rock of our salvation. Let us enter into his presence with thanksgiving, and let us shout triumphantly to him in song. For the Lord is a great God, a great king above all gods. The depths of the earth are in his hand, and the mountain peaks are his. The sea is his, and he made it. His hands formed the dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are his people of his pasture, the sheep that are under his care." Let us pray. Father, we do thank this morning as we come together now this time of worship, a time of giving ourselves to you. And Lord, we do ask for a blessing upon this morning. That the songs that we sing, they are pleasing and they lift it up to you. And the words that you have given to Adam to in his message that he will give to us later, that it helps to inspire and lift us even higher and closer to you. So, Lord, we do thank you. And most of all, we give thanks to your son, Jesus Christ, who went to Calvary's cross and died for our sin. These things we ask in his name. Amen. Now, if you'd like to get up this morning and kind of greet one another before we start our worship service. Can you sit? Our time to worship this morning. We're going to lift our hearts up in a time of worship as well. When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required.
the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. King of endless wealth, no one could express how much you deserve. No one we can hold. All I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song. A song in itself is not what you have. Search much deeper within, though the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for things I've made it, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. Lord, it's all about you. I bring you more than a song. I'll bring you more than a song, more than a song. You're looking into my heart, into my heart. You're looking into into my heart.
Amen. That's a beautiful song. I just love the words to that song. There's so much more than just coming here Sunday morning and us singing and, you know, giving ourselves daily to the Lord and giving Him everything that we have. It's just, but that's just a beautiful song to kind of reflect on that. Oh.
With all of my days,
This morning, giving our praise to you, lifting you up higher and higher. And Father, we just know that with each thing we do and each thing we say and every song and every word that we speak, you do, you look into our heart. And we don't always do and say and think the right things, but Father, we know that you are there helping us, guiding us. And Lord, we just want to try to be closer. Try to abide in you each and every day, each and every hour of each and every day. But Father, sweetest, we thank you, and we love you, and we give this love through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who we pray here this morning to. Amen. You can be seated. And we got a few kiddos out there this morning. I know mine are down in Florida at the moment, our grandkids, and I think we got some others missing, but we got two or three out there this morning that can come on up.
All right, well, I think the lunchbox did not make it back. Oh, it did make it back. Okay, fantastic. Wonderful. Can I have that? Thank you very much. So I know everyone here is familiar with this, but folks that might be watching online may not realize that every week I send home this lunchbox with one of the kiddos. They put something in it, and this becomes the prompt for our children's message. And now, what are these? They kind of look like maybe swim pants for a doll or something like that. Is that what those are? Are they a pair of shorts or swim trunks or something? They're swimming trunks. Okay. So what do I do with a pair of swimming trunks for a doll? Give me just a moment to gain my composure here. Okay. So I'm thinking, would these fit you? No. It's for your dolls. Okay, yeah, these wouldn't fit me either. Okay, because I'm a little bit too big for these britches here. Okay, so if we think about something that doesn't fit, okay, this is too small because I'm not bigger than that. I couldn't wear these, right? Okay, so if I think of these being too small and I'm being too big, I've kind of, you could say, outgrown these, right? Okay, so you've outgrown these. These wouldn't fit you. And there's clothes that you're wearing today that you're not going to be able to wear, you know, next year because you're still growing, right? Now, fortunately, some of us have gotten to the age where we can still wear our clothes from year to year, but you guys are still growing. You're not going to be able to wear the same stuff you know, more than like a year or two, because you're going to outgrow them. Now, in the Bible, Paul talks about how when I was a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child, he behaved like a child, but he says, when I became a man, when I grew up, I put those childish things away anymore because they weren't appropriate. They didn't fit anymore. And so when we think about something like old clothes that don't fit us because they're too small, it shows that we're growing. And because if we're a follower of Jesus, we're always supposed to be growing. We're always supposed to be changing. So like the things that you do now are not the same things that you did a couple of years ago. Okay, I hear your little sibling back there crying, right? That's your baby brother, yeah. So he's making some noise. So the thing is, he doesn't behave the same way that you do, right? Because you're grown up more, okay? And so when you grow up, you change the way that you behave because you become what's called mature. And God says that I want you to grow up. I want you to become more and more, well, when he says grown up, he doesn't just mean like physically getting taller. He says, I want you to become more and more like Jesus. I want you to be more and more like me. And that's how you grow up. And so some of the things that maybe we used to do, you know what? That's not really the way that God wants me to be anymore. That's not what Jesus wants me to do. I've matured beyond that. Those things don't fit anymore, just like these little shorts wouldn't fit. So that's what I was thinking of with the shorts. You really gave me a challenge with these things. This is a little bit harder than normal. Okay, I'm going to give the shorts back to you. Okay, you ready? You ready to catch? Okay, wasn't a very good throw on my part. Okay, so can you guys pray with me? Lord, I thank you that you are growing us. You don't leave us where we are. You move us forward, and we never stop growing. Even if we're adults, we still keep growing in you. And I pray for these young ones here that they would know what it is to grow physically, but they would also know what it is to grow to be more and more like Jesus every day. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Well, this means it goes to your family, okay? There you go. And you guys can follow out that direction. And I'll have some time to pray now with our, is there any special music this morning? There is? Okay. So we'll have the special music first, then I'll come in and lead us in prayer. Okay, well, it's our opportunity to pray together as a church family. Wanted to give you a few updates. One, I was glad to have Bev back with us. She was out with a leg infection, was hospitalized, and then was home recovering, and she said that she still got some more antibiotics to do, but glad that she can be back with us. Pray for the Rubles. They're going to be heading to Kentucky this week to help with her family and doing some rebuilding of the home that's was hit by the floods. So they're going to be down there for a while with that. Pray for safety and a successful completion of that work. Christy shared with me that her folks are doing much better. Her mom is over whatever it was she had. Is she over it fully now? Okay. And so she's recovering well after her knee surgery. Do be praying for Curtis because he's going to be coming up on a knee surgery in 2 weeks, you said? Okay. Also, Alice's dad, Ed Brandstetter, he is home after being in the hospital with blood sugar issues. Apparently, did you say it was over 900 at one point? Yeah, his sugar was at one point. So he's back home and doing much better, but still has, you know, a road to recovery as well. And Doris shared with me that her husband, Don, had some heart issues this week as well. So those are the ones I was made aware of already this morning. Are there other prayer reports, praise reports that you have to share? Pat. Tom who?
Wilson.
Tom Wilson. Okay. Now, you mentioned these, but I'm unfamiliar with the situations with them. What's... Okay. Okay, so the Sims family and the Wilson family, is both of them have lost loved ones. Others? Isaiah? Okay, yeah, the hurricane recovery, definitely. And then pray for safety for our church family, various people who are traveling this week as well. I know the Noltings, the Morrises, I'm not sure who else might be traveling right now too. Are there others? Okay. Well, let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Father, you are awesome. You are magnificent. You are full of love and compassion, wisdom, and all honor is due to you. We give you worship and honor, recognition of who you are. And Father, I pray that you this morning would help us to recognize you more fully. Thanks so much for your work in these folks' lives. The Bev is her healing. I know Lois has continued to improve as well. And Lord, I pray for John and Linda as they head down to Kentucky that this reconstruction effort would be completely safe, it would be successful, and that it would also be speedy. But it would be a really good time of connecting with family as they are down there. We also thank you that Christy's parents are doing so much better. And we pray for Curtis as he prepares to go in for the surgery that he would be at peace, that it would be completely successful for him as well. Thanks to Ed is home and is doing better. I pray that he get this sugar issue under control. We pray for Don too, that his that you would show him what he needs to do so that he is attending to the heart that you have given him. We pray for the Wilson family and the Sims family, as both of them have lost loved ones, that you would give them comfort. And also safety for our church family who are traveling right now. And as there is so much recovery still going on in Kentucky, also now from the hurricane, in each of those situations, Father, I pray that you would send your people with your resources to do your work and to share about your son. I pray that they would be well received, they would sacrifice well, and that they would be great missionaries in these various situations. And Father, for us as a church, I know that we are not yet the people that you want us to be. You are growing us, just like I shared with the kids. And I pray, Father, that we would partner with you in that growth. We would submit to you in the process of what it is that you are doing. And Father, that we would become a people that are the bride that you want us to be. I pray that this morning you would speak your word clearly to us. In Jesus' name I pray this. Amen. Okay, before we start, I'm going to fix this microphone because it's driving me nuts. Hang on just a second. Okay, hopefully that's a little bit better. It just kept wanting to fall away from my face a little bit. So this is going to be an interactive moment. I would like to know from the church pitch-ins here. Some people call them potlucks. We call it a pitch-in, you know, some covered dish affair. The times when we all bring food and we gather down in the basement, what are the foods that you most look forward to down there? Okay, I'm going to tell you right off the bat what mine is. It's Betty's pies. Okay, so what other foods do you guys look forward to sharing when we get together? Oh my goodness. You certainly eat it without any problem. So which ones do you like?
Green beans.
Green beans, Isaiah? The mashed potatoes, yep. Of course, these are usually the things I'm making too, the mashed potatoes. That's usually my contribution. Dessert in general. Christy's not picky. All right, other things? Olmsted's corn, okay.
Fresh fruit.
Others? Bob? Chicken. Oh, I am hearing a chorus of chicken out there, okay. Yeah. I know for me, with it, I'm kind of with Christy on the dessert thing. I usually get like little slices of about five different things. Pat, what are you going to say?
Broccoli casserole.
Broccoli casserole. I liked your Brussels sprouts, too, that you brought a while back, Daryl. Those are good. So when we have those kind of affairs, we get together, the food is all spread out, okay? It's what's called a pitch-in because everybody pitches in something to share. Each person contributes so that each person can benefit. All right, everybody brings something, and everybody shares something. And then everybody is taken care of. This morning, we are going to look in the scriptures at a church pitch-in, but it's a different kind of pitch-in. Okay, so turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. We are going to look at two verses this morning. Now, there might be some other verses we're going to pull in, but there's going to be two verses, one in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and we'll eventually get to another one in Colossians. As we do this and we look at this, I want you to understand what it looks like for this kind of church pitch-in. Now, again, I don't have a whole lot up on the screens. I do have those two particular verses that we're going to share. But as we get into this, I'll give you a little bit of context, okay? 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and we're going to read 26. All right. What is the outcome then, brethren, when you assemble? Each one has a psalm, has a teaching, has a revelation, has a tongue, has an interpretation. Let all things be done for edification. Now, we're just going to look at this one verse, and we're going to kind of take it piece by piece as we go through. Okay, first of all, what is the outcome then, brethren? That means that there is a purpose. When we get together, there is a purpose. And the next thing it says is when you assemble. Okay? This is talking about when the people of God get together. This is a church service. Now, when I say service, that's probably not the right word for it. We should probably call it a church gathering. It doesn't seem that they necessarily had services the same way that we do. You know, it's this pre-planned order, and this is exactly the way it went. We're really giving us a little bit of detail, very little detail as to what their church gatherings looked like. We know that they usually included teaching of the word. They included singing. They included prayer. And they often included food. So as, you know, think of those things, but exactly how this flowed from one to another, I'm sure they didn't have some sort of printed order of service. So it was a little bit different, but their church gatherings included these different elements, okay? And it says each one has something, okay? So it was a pitch-in, at least for the church in Corinth. This is described to us. It's not told we have to do it this way. But he's saying, when you guys get together, each one of you has something that you're contributing. Now, this is not talking about food. He's talking here, each one contributes a psalm. Each one contributes something else to the gathering. So lots of different people were sharing whatever it was that they brought with them in the way of a message or some words to go across, okay? Now, we're going to walk through these different things that it says that they shared, okay? Each one of you has a psalm. This would be a psalm. It could be something, a psalm from the Old Testament. It could be a hymn or some other kind of piece of music. But just like, you know, Charity shared a special music the other, about a month or two ago, we had that music evening when we got together, and lots of different people came contributing. Each person came contributing something, and some of them had music that they were contributing. Other people were contributing a teaching. This would be like what I do. This is an explanation of Scripture. Here's what the Scripture says. Here's what we need to do with it. Here's what it means. Some people came with a revelation. Now, this is something a little bit different in the fact that this is revealing God's message to the church, but not necessarily a message that is an explanation of a particular verse in Scripture. Okay? So this could be in the area of prophecy. You could think of it that way. So if you think of like the Old Testament prophets, they revealed God's word and God's will to the people. Now, a lot of times, we think of prophecy as being foretelling the future, which that can be a part of it. Sometimes God will say, this is coming in the future. You need to be ready for it. This is coming in the future. You need to repent. But a lot of times, if you look at the Old Testament prophets, what do? They say, God has already said, and this is what you need to do with it. They're taking God's revealed word and applying it to the specific situation. So a revelation could look like a person getting up and saying, God has said this. This is what is going on in our community. This is what's going on in our world. So this is what we need to do. Okay, that prophetic word, which is often a challenging word. Sometimes it's encouraging. Sometimes it's corrective. Sometimes it's challenging. And there's been times when we've had that as well, when somebody gets up here, me or somebody else, and says, you know what? We need to get our act together. This is what's going on. This is what God has said. We need to do this. So it's a little bit more of a challenging revelation, okay? But any kind of revelation always needs to be consistent with Scripture, and it always needs to be designed for our application, for our action. If we just hear a revelation from God, and it does not result in some kind of action on our parts, we've missed the meaning. God doesn't just talk to talk, okay? He talks to reveal, and he talks to motivate us and drive us in the direction that we are supposed to go. And then you get this last part where it talks about a tongue and interpretation. Now, the tongue, this is something that is going to be, some of you have had exposure to this and some have not. Speaking in tongues is when a person, by the Holy Spirit's power, talks in an unknown language. Now, I say unknown. It's unknown usually to most of the people who are hearing. It can be in a known language, such as in Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost, and there was people from all over the Mediterranean world who had gathered together in Jerusalem. And it says, each of us hears these believers, these Christians, speaking in our own language. Some were Parthians, some were Medes, some were Egyptians, some were Libyans, some were from Crete. Everybody was hearing in their own language. So it can be that, where it is a known and recognized language, but it can also be in an unknown language, an angelic tongue, a heavenly language, and none of us are going to know what it means unless the Holy Spirit gives the ability for somebody to interpret it, which is that next part there. Okay, interpretation, which is this supernatural ability to understand and to share the meaning of what is being said. Now, in the first part of 1 Corinthians 14, which we're not going to go back and unpack all of that, Paul is talking with them about the gifts and the benefit or the purpose of what those gifts are. Okay, some people have a gift of speaking in tongues or interpretation or whatever, but he's saying that there's a really specific purpose as to why this is given. There's something that is supposed to happen. And Paul already talked about it here. All things are to be done for edification. Now, what is edification? If you've heard of what an edifice is, okay, it's a building, something that is built up. And so he's saying that we need to make sure that these gifts of the Holy Spirit, if somebody comes and has something that they want to share with the church family, it should be done for edification, to build up, to strengthen, to move people on towards maturity. So the problem with the speaking in tongues was if somebody's up here and they're saying something that sounds just like gibberish, even if the Holy Spirit is inspiring them, it doesn't do the listeners a bit of good. It doesn't help anybody because they can't understand what's being said. And so tongues and interpretation always need to go together because you always have to reach the point of understanding. If you don't reach the point of understanding, it does not edify. And if it does not edify, we're not supposed to do it. Now, each one of you who has the Holy Spirit inside of you has been given a spiritual gift or several spiritual gifts. Each one of us, if the Holy Spirit comes to dwell inside of us, he gives us those supernatural enablings. But he does not do it primarily for your benefit. If I exercise my gift of teaching, that can be really satisfying for me, but that's not the point of it. The point is to benefit the people who are listening. Same with tongues, interpretation, prophecy. Anybody who is exercising their gift, And even the gifts that are not the speaking kind of gifts, you know, serving, helps, administration, leadership, all of those things are to be done for the benefit of others. So when you receive that gift from the Holy Spirit, it is not primarily for you. It is for you to use in as a benefit to others. That's the point, to strengthen, to mature, and to build up. Now I'm going to read you a verse earlier from 1 Corinthians, verse 12. So you also, since you are zealous for spiritual gifts, apparently it was something they're really interested in, seek to abound for the edification of the church. Focus, you know, these people were wanting gifts, and it's seemingly like they probably wanted to have these more supernatural kind of gifts, like the whole idea of speaking in tongues. He's saying, seek to abound for the edification of the church. It is much better to speak 5 words that people can understand than 10,000 words that they can't. Now, I'm sure that you guys have probably heard teachers or preachers sometimes, and they get up and they use a whole bunch of $50 words when they're talking. You know, you're the eschatological manifestation of the blah, 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 blah. And you're like, what did you just say? That doesn't make a lick of sense to me. Speak in a way that people can understand. You know, whether this is the speaking in tongues that needs interpretation or even a person getting up to reveal something in teaching or prophecy, make sure that it is understood by the people that are listening. Otherwise, it does not edify. Now, when you share, you make it understandable. Now, that's an instruction to individuals is to edify, but how do you coordinate many individuals, which is like what is happening here in Corinth, who have, everybody wants to share. Okay, if a person, if you get a bunch of different people coming, how do you help this to not become chaos? Okay, and that's what Paul talks about after verse 26, but I'm just going to jump down and read to you verse 40, okay? It says, all things must be done properly and in an orderly manner. When we have our pitch-ins downstairs, what do? All the food is laid out, and typically it's kind of grouped, right? You've got your entrees, you've got your side dishes, you've got Christy's favorite table, the dessert table, you know, the same one that most of us like to gravitate to, right? It's ordered, and then we pray, and then people get in line, usually going down both sides of the table, and they take turns. Now, occasionally you get the line cutter, right? Somebody comes, oh, excuse me, I got to get this, and they kind of reach through because they needed a little bit of butter, they need a little bit of this, but we don't just have it be a free-for-all. If it's a free-for-all, it's chaos. There will be spills, there will be messes, a person's going to get elbowed or knocked over. It's not good if there's chaos. It has to be done in an orderly manner. And the rest of this chapter here, he says, you know, when people speak, you take turns, you respect each other. If somebody else has something to share, the first person stops, lets this person speak. Things need to be done in an orderly way. But I want to focus on specifically the fact that we do this for a purpose. Anything that we share is for the purpose of helping others. And I want to focus especially on in verse 26 where it says, each of you. Each person. When you guys come together, each person has something to share. Now, in our culture, the way our church services are structured, typically, you've got an assigned or predetermined group of people who are up front. And those are the people that share, and everybody who's in the seats, they're the ones who are receiving. Okay? That's like a restaurant, okay, where it's like you've got certain people who are receiving, other people are bringing and giving the food. So it flows just one way. Contrast that with a pitch-in, everybody brings, everybody contributes, everybody benefits, which is apparently the way it was happening in Corinth. Now, I talked with Gary Roland, our missionary in New York City, and he was talking about how this is the way their church does it. Now, his church meets in like their condo or their apartment there. It's a very small group of people, but they come together with the expectation that it's not just Gary who's going to be preaching a sermon. Everybody is coming with something to contribute. Here's what God has done during the week. Here's what God has taught me as I've been in the scriptures. Here's what my wife and I have been discovering. Here's the opportunities that God has brought our way. And they're each giving and receiving. So there's been some times before when we've done testimonies here, you know, and kind of pass around the microphone. People can stand up and say, you know, here's what God's been teaching me. Here's what God's been doing. And I'd like us to get back to doing that a little bit more because of the fact that it will really help us as we see God speaking to us through us, not just God speaking to us through me or Walt or John or whoever's up front here. We all can contribute. And I got to say, too, if you are not participating in some kind of smaller group of Christians who are sharing together, you're really missing out. Our Wednesday night Bible study, our Sunday school class downstairs, you know, we've got a Tuesday morning women's group, Tuesday morning men's group, and there's other groups, you know, Bible study fellowship that are outside of our church. If you are not participating in some smaller group where you can know and be known, you can hear insights from other people, different people asking questions, and you're growing together in the Word, you're really missing out. That's where it's at. It is good sometimes to hear a prepared message, but it is also good to get together and let's discuss, let's share together. So I want to close with, and I say close, okay, this is not the closing, this is transitioning just to the next verse, okay? I told you there was two verses this morning. 1 Corinthians 14:26, the next one is Colossians 3:16, okay? And this is going to tell you how to prepare for a pitch-in. How do you prepare for a pitch-in? Now, when I was back at Taylor University and I was applying for the job to work in the admissions office there, they gave me kind of some scenarios. Okay, how would you respond to this if you're at a college fair? How would you respond to this kind of group? And my friend Gary, our missionary in New York City, okay, he'd already worked there a year, and I was applying to get hired on. And so they gave me this scenario. Hey, you're in this group gathering. Some people have gotten together. They want to hear more about the university. They've gotten a few friends together, and some people have brought some food. And so it's like, okay, just kind of have at it. They threw it out. There's an impromptu, like, drama type thing. Okay, so I get up there, and I said, oh, well, hey, thanks, everybody, for inviting me. I'm glad to be here with you. And, you know, Cindy, this is a really nice casserole that you prepared. And, oh, I just love the way that you cooked this ham for us. And, oh, Gary, thanks for bringing the bag of chips. And everybody laughed. Not just because of the fact, okay, Gary at that point was a single bachelor guy, okay, so didn't really apparently know that much about cooking or wouldn't take the time to do it. But actually, when they got together as a staff, that's what Gary would do. He would bring the bag of chips. So when you get together for a pitch-in, you know, it's not necessarily wrong to go by and swing by the store. I'm going to go to Walmart, go grab a bag of chips and then run to the pitch-in. But what does everybody enjoy the most at a pitch-in? You enjoy the things that have been cooked for a while, right? Things that have had a little bit of care and love shown to them, things that have been prepared, okay? So as a church, when we get together and we're coming, we need to come with more than just a bag of chips. Don't just bring the chips with you. Bring something that you have spent some time preparing. And I'm not saying that it has to be a message. Not that it has to be a sermon. You know, you don't have to get up and talk for 30 minutes. Bring something that is more along the lines of this. The crock pot. I love crock pots. Now, I don't know if I told you, but when we got married, you know, people get us stuff off our gift registry. We received 5 crock pots for our wedding. A bunch of people thought that these were a good idea. Now, what's the beauty of a crock pot? Okay, one is that you kind of fix it and forget it. You can walk away. But the thing is the thing that cooks in a crock pot, it's not something that you cook quickly. It's something that has to cook for a while. And especially if you've got, you know, your meat, your carrots, your potatoes, maybe a few greens or something like that, and it's been simmering along with all the spices for hours and hours and hours. The flavor of that meat permeates everything that you eat. It has been cooked in over a period of time. When we are coming together as a church family, don't just come to receive. And preferably, don't come with just a bag of chips. Put something in the crock pot and let God let you marinate in that for a while. What has God taught you during the week? What is he doing in you? Is he cooking in you something like in a slow cooker? This is something that is the flavor is going to be, the flavor is going to be thoroughly within you. Now, let's go ahead and look at that verse in Colossians. Colossians chapter 3, verse 16. And I think you might see a little bit what I'm talking about here, okay? Colossians 3:16, let the word of Christ richly dwell within you, with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your hearts to God. In this verse, you see a crock pot. You see something that has been simmering. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, abundantly. Okay, let that flavor flow through you. So if we think from the perspective of the church being a pigeon, we come together next Sunday. I would love for each of us to come ready to share and say, here is what God has been teaching me this week. Jesus has been doing this in me. Jesus has been doing this through me. Here's what I see him doing around me. This verse has just meant so much. Or you could say, this verse has kicked my behind this week. Come ready to share something that God has been doing in you. And as you put that on the table and others can sample from it, it will edify, it will nourish, it will build up, it will strengthen, it will mature. It is not the professional minister, it is not the person with a title, you know, a particular role, are the only ones that are supposed to share. We are all supposed to help feed each other. And when it says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, this, I didn't realize it until this week, let the word of Christ indwell you in you richly. Okay, it's the word in there is in there twice, kind of, in that verse. So when you think of dwelling, okay, this is not the same as the word remain or abide, which is what we studied in our Sunday school class this morning. But it has a very similar meaning. In your sermon notes there, you see that there's a little picture of a house. To dwell in means to make a place your dwelling. To go in, to move in, and to make it your home. Let the word of Christ, now this is not talking about Jesus' words as much as it is the word or the message about Jesus. Let the message about Jesus come inside, open the door, come in, and make himself at home. And as he makes himself at home, he begins to customize that home. Anybody who has moved into a new house, you know, you go in and you do not leave it the same as what it was. You move some things around. You may repaint, you may remodel. You customize that home for your needs, your personality, your purposes. When Jesus moves into your life, he wants to do a remodel. He wants to dwell there richly, not just dwell as a guest. Okay, as a guest, I don't go through changing stuff in people's homes. I leave it the way it is. It's their home, it's not mine. When Jesus comes in and he dwells within you, he is going to make it his home. And as that home takes on more and more of his character, other people from the outside are going to see it. So let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, abundantly, a lot of it in there. There's a lot of flavor, going back to our earlier metaphor. Okay? And then it says, what's going to be the result of that? With all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another. As Jesus is in you, he's going to help you think his thoughts. And as you start to think his thoughts, those thoughts are going to become your words. And as those his thoughts become your words, they are going to go out, and they're going to help to instruct others as well, to admonish, to build them up, to encourage, to make that person more like Jesus as well. And then it says to do it specifically with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Now, not all of us are musicians, but I know that there's a lot more people who like to sing that are not necessarily musicians. You can still take the word of God, the truth of God, in song and use that to encourage each other. If it's God's truth, it's God's truth, whether it's quoted directly from the Bible or whether it's put to music. You can use this to help other people grow as well. And then it says to do so with thankfulness in your hearts to God. As you are thankful for what God is doing in you, other people are going to see it. You cannot have Christ dwelling richly within you without him spilling over out of you. and then spilling over onto the other people around you. So how do you prepare for a church pitch-in? Which is really, how do you prepare for any church gathering? Anytime God's people get together, it should be a pitch-in. You might hear more from one person than from another. But ask the Lord this week, God, what do you want me to share with my church family? As you abide with him, and if you feel like, oh man, I've got nothing to give, I've got nothing to prepare, don't worry about that. Just spend time with Jesus. He will give you something that is meaningful to you that you can in turn share with others. And as we are together next week, it's going to be a pitch-in. Okay? I will come prepared to share, but only for a short time. I'm not going to have a full sermon next week because we are going to preach to each other. Okay? Each of the elders is going to be prepared to share something as well. But I want for each member of our church family, come prepared to share. Now, that does not mean that everybody has to get up and share up front. Okay? It's not a requirement. I got to pass around the microphone to each single person. Okay, what's your thing that you have to share? Because if you look at 1 Corinthians 14, it kind of limits it. Okay, so many people are going to share, and then you kind of, so many other people are going to share in this way. It doesn't mean that everybody has to, but everybody should become prepared to share. I've got something to offer. And if God lays it on your heart as we're together, we're going to give you the opportunity. Okay, we're going to have some testimony time. If you think I would rather share in song than I would in word, that's okay as well. Okay? We'll work that out if you want to share that way. Although it might be nice to know a little bit ahead of time if there's going to be any sort of music with it. Okay? If you want to sing something a cappella, that's fine. If you want to get up and say, 10 seconds, here's what God's doing. Or you could even say, here is a verse that's meaningful to me. You read it and you say why. It could be that simple. It doesn't have to be anything elaborate. But according to what we see in 1 Corinthians, church is a pitch-in. And we should each come ready to share. If you share up front, you share from your seat, or you may even share informally with people as you're just shaking hands. Here's what God's been doing. And I think that what we should do, this just came to me right now, next week when we get together, when we have our greeting time or when you are interacting with folks, I think you should ask them a question. Put them on the spot. So what'd you bring this week? Okay, when we've got a pitch-in, we see stuff down on the table. It's like, oh, Pat, what'd you bring? Is yours the corn? Is yours the beans? Is yours the meatloaf? What is it? I'm going to ask, what did you bring to the pitch-in? We should ask each other. And it's not saying, it's not putting somebody on the spot. It's not meant to put somebody on the spot. It might, but that's not the purpose of it. The purpose is, I know God's been pouring into you this week. I want to know what he's been doing in your life. I want to celebrate with you. I want to hear, I want to receive from you because we are each able to feed each other. Everybody contributes, so everybody's nourished, so everybody benefits. That's how we edify the church, when each person does their part. So we're going to have our closing song. And I want to encourage you, be praying, God, what do you want me to contribute? What do you want me to share? And if God may lay something on your heart right now, but if there's not anything that's just rising to the surface, that's okay. You've got a whole week for him to put stuff in that crock pot and let it simmer. And when we come together next week, I am so excited to be able to hear what God has given to each one of us. So ask God that question. God, what do you want me to give? Be ready to receive. And right now, be ready to give back to him.
We worship and adore.
Isaiah just told me that he actually has something he'd like to share now. So I'm going to let Isaiah go ahead and share now. And then, so go ahead, bud.
So a verse that really stuck out to me was, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That stuck out to me because when God calls you to something, we're usually really nervous beforehand. And we're like, oh, I'm not strong enough. Oh, I can't do it. But you can do it when you have Christ by your side. So that really stuck out to me.
Amen. That's him.
Thanks.
All right, buddy.
Yeah. And let me ask, does anybody else have something that is on your heart to share? Don't feel any pressure. But, I mean, obviously, I didn't actually even extend the invitation to do it, but God laid it on his heart to share. Very appropriate, very encouraging, very edifying. So if anybody else has something that you'd like to share, let me know. Daryl?
What he said is so true. Because it happened to me when I decided to play a trumpet solo here for the first time, and I was so nervous, and people said, well, you didn't seem like you was, but just before I put the trumpet to my lips, I froze. I held it, I closed my eyes, and I asked the Lord to get me through it, and lo and behold, I was calm, and I got through it, and I didn't make one mistake, and I asked him, and he came through for me. And it's so right. If you got him by your side and you know it, you're going to get through it.
Praise God for that. Anybody else have something you want to share? All right. Well, let me pray, and then I'll dismiss us. Father God, thank you so much for what you have done just right now of giving us a very specific demonstration of what it is that you want us to do when we gather together. And I thank you for the encouragement from these two brothers here as they have shared of your word and your faithfulness. Isaiah shared specifically a scripture and the general application, and then Daryl shared a testimony of how you saw that come together, one playing off the other. And we trust that when we get together next week, even though we don't know what everybody's bringing, we know that you have orchestrated the menu, and it will be a feast. We look forward to it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, well, you guys are dismissed. I look forward to feasting with you next week.
I'll give you